Let me ask you a question. I mean, this transitions us into the conversation we had yesterday, right? Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And the conversation is about God. Right now, if you look at God, the debate for God is what? Let's look at the debates for God. There's how many different camps with God?
Oh, so many.
There is the camp of people who believe there is a God. And within that camp, there's how many religions? A ton.
Too many. Yeah.
Pick and choose. But mm-hmm. there's a ton, mm-hmm. right? You know, Judaism, Christianity, LDS, Jehovah, Muslim. You know, if you want to put Scientology in that camp.
Catholicism,
Buddhism, Taoism.
Buddhism, Taoism. Yeah. Sikhs, there's a lot of them, right? But they believe there is a creator, there's a God. The other camp is what? Well, agnostic, they believe there is a God, they just don't know.
Not convinced.
Not convinced. And then you have the atheist that flat out believes what? There's not a God.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
The community for atheists, believe it or not, is very small. It's only like 4 million people. It's not a big number. It's
worldwide?
It's not a big number. If you look at them, can you Kai pull up what percentage of the world... Total atheist population worldwide. I think it's not a big number. It's a small number. Anyway, so we got three different camps.
Okay. I thought it would be larger than that.
Yeah, me too.
U.S. is 3 million. Worldwide is what? 450 to 500 million. There are 450 70%. Atheists and agnostic. Wait a minute, because that's not the same thing. So atheist and agnostic, I don't put them in the same camp. Mm-hmm. Agnostic is a complete different understanding than atheist.
Agnostic, so, just to be clear, I think atheism is you basically say there is no
nothing.
God. Yeah, agnostic is you're not sure if there is or there isn't. You just
right.
don't know.
Yeah, that's you don't okay. know, which is fine. So that's not like a no matter what, there's not a God. Okay, so it's okay, Kai. We'll figure it out later, okay? So now, today, with everything that's going on, okay, do we have more people believing in God today or fewer people believing in God today?
I would guess fewer.
Percentage-wise.
I don't know. Because
Not population, percentage-wise.
I think, well, it depends. When you say God, like when people start using the term like celestial creator or a universal energy, I feel like they're still believing in God. They're believing in something. Like when you talked about people praying, you know, how praying centers you and that people should pray more. I'm like, man, I feel like people talk about prayer now more than when I was a kid. They just rebranded it as manifesting. Manifest. Right. Manifest
or
your
the
future.
Secret.
Yeah, and it's like, that was praying.
They're scared
like, is
to talk
that not
about
praying?
It for some reason.
Yeah.
No, they use the word meditation.
Yeah.
I meditate is what I do. And rather than saying prayer, they use meditation. It's a more politically correct word.
Or affirmations as
yeah.
well.
Meditation is slightly different than affirmation. Affirmation is restating the same thing over and over and over again mm-hmm. until you believe it. Meditation is more you're sitting there, you're praying, you're thinking about a topic.
What do you do, Pat?
No, I listen, I got to tell you. I mean, for me, prayer is magical. You know, Tom's in a hospital. Tom's in a hospital with pneumonia and COVID, right?
Tom Zenner?
Yeah. Tom Ellsworth.
No, Tom Ellsworth?
He's in a hospital with pneumonia. He was in ICU for the last couple of days.
Yeah, so the BizDoc?
The BizDoc. So
what?
Yes, he's there now.
Man,
today's his best day.
Okay,
today's
good.
His best day.
Okay, which good. Is BizDoc. I hope you're listening. We're thinking of you, man.
We can't wait
we
to
miss
have
you.
Him. Yeah, everybody right. misses
I
BizDoc.
Is there any chance he's gonna be here for the vault? Or?
We don't know. We're gonna see what's
right,
gonna
well,
at this point.
The only thing
we're thinking about is his health, right?
That's right.
So prayer, okay? Prayer to me. But I think about like we went to the question and said, okay, what country would you rather raise your kids in? Would you rather live in a country where the top believes in certain values and principle and there being a God, or the top believes in there is no God, they're atheists, they're agnostic, like, you know, whatever, we don't need to follow a certain guidelines.
Judeo-Christian values.
You prefer that.
Values and principle, yeah.
Well, that's what we grew up with.
But let's take that out. Let's take that out.
Mm-hmm.
And let's say we don't have that. What does mm-hmm. that world look like? Let's take that out. Let's take it out and say, listen, I think it's like, you know, I used to go to school. We used to pray. You don't do that anymore. You used to go to school. You used to stand up to, you know, the flag. You don't do that. I mean, it's offensive. We used to go and do certain rituals, right? I remember one time I'm at the owner of Public Storage's house in L.A., in Malibu. Beautiful home. And Dennis Prager got up and he says, what makes great countries great and what makes religions great is rituals. And he's a Jew. And, you know, mm-hmm. Jews have a lot of
symbolism and rituals,
right? We used to pray. We don't do that anymore. So imagine like you're standing up and praying to a flag or standing up and saluting to a flag or looking up to a flag. What does that do to a 6-year-old? What does it do to an 8-year-old? What does it do to a 10-year-old? What does it do when you pray? Do you really believe in prayer at that time? Do you sit there and say, oh my gosh, prayer works? Or do you sit there and say, what if this works? I don't know if this works. What does a kid think about? But at least you're thinking, right? Mm-hmm. Well, maybe someone's got my back. Maybe someone's watching me. Is it good to think a creator is watching us? Have we gotten away from that? Why don't we want a creator to watch us? Is it because we don't like accountability? Is it because we want to be kind of rebels and not have anybody hold us accountable? What is it? Like what? Or is it because we had a bad experience with a pastor, with a preacher, with a priest? Something happened. We're like, dude, I don't believe in any churches. That's what happened with me. I was an atheist for 25 years. But the more and more you see the world being a little bit out of whack, the more and more you question, you know what? I don't know. Maybe we need a little bit more faith today, not fate. Maybe we need a little bit more prayer today. Maybe we need somebody to just get up and say, you know what, America? Times are a little bit weird. I think we got to pray today. And we have somebody that just sits there like, you know, like flat out. A person gets up there and prays for the entire country today. What if that happened? How would the world react? How would America react? Maybe the man upstairs, if there is a man upstairs, is not happy. Maybe imagine if a father did so much for his kid and his kids are so spoiled. How would that father react? How would the father react? Would the father sit there? Yesterday, I was doing a mentoring call on the Elite webinar. One of the guys, got a kid named George, liked him. And I said, so tell me, George. He says, well, let me tell you, you know, I think of myself as one of these Bill Gates type of guys. I'm very cold. Nothing offends me. I don't get upset. Like, he's talking a big game. He's 23 years old. I said, so really, what kind of business do you run? He says, I don't run a business. I work for my father. My father, you know, he doesn't know what he's doing. I said, well, your dad doesn't know what he's doing? No, he really doesn't know what he's doing. I said, so what is your dad doing? He owns a bunch of hotels in Greece, and he's got a big portfolio of real estate of 100-some million dollars, but I do it all for him. I said, really? You manage it? Yeah. And we got all these seven other CEOs that are watching us that do 20, 100 million a year in business. I said, so tell me who needs who more? Do you need your dad, or does he need you more? Oh, no question. My dad can't survive without me. I'm like, oh, really? He said, yeah. I said, so what are you going to do? He said, well, next year I'm going to go away from my dad and do it on my own. I said, fantastic. What's your game plan? He's going to give me a few million dollars to get started. I'm like, everybody starts cracking. I'm like, did you hear yourself?
So my dad did for me. It was fine.
Yeah. So maybe if there is a creator, just maybe this creator, if there is, and he plays the role of a father, maybe he's a little bit disappointed with all the stuff that we have.
100%.
Maybe. I don't know. Gerard, what are your thoughts?
It's a long conversation. I gotta tell you, man, I am a man of faith. I believe in a creator. I believe in a universe. I have a weird belief that we are all connected of the same energy. I think science has kind of proven that matter cannot be created or destroyed. We're all stardust. We're all interconnected. And what I said yesterday is that I believe in a collective consciousness. I believe there's this thing called noetic science that kind of studies this. But there's a reason why home field advantage works. Their collective consciousness is a real thing. There's a reason why prayer groups seem to actually have effect, right? So I think our collective consciousness is off right now. I think there's something, there is sand in the microchip. I personally don't have much like or use for religion. I think faith is of God, religion is of man. And I think religion has been a tool used for authorities and not unlike government in this regard. I feel like it is a thing for people that are addicted to power to use to try to take power and control over their fellow man.
Let me jump in on that, if you don't mind.
Yeah, yeah.
Because this came up on my app this morning, and I love what you just said. It says from Ephesians 6:12, it says, "For our wrestling is not against flesh and blood, but against the principalities, against the powers, against the world rulers of this darkness, against the spiritual hosts of wickedness in the heavenly places." So you know what that basically means, is that we're going through a lot of craziness right now in this world. And that we need to be guarded, extremely guarded. And therefore, we need to come together. No matter if you believe in God or whatever, we need to come together. And Pat, you brought up a great story about your son, you know, praying, you know, showing prayer and stuff like that. At the end of the day, whether you believe in prayer or not, it's just positivity. We need to come together in some way and understand that something's wrong. And in order to get right, we got to get right with ourselves, and we need to really have better conversations. When you say, you know, I hear people say, love thy neighbor, this and that. You're just saying it. You're not doing it. Mm. We're living in a world of just words, words, words. No actions, no real honesty. Hypocrisy is at an all-time high with our leaders and all that stuff. We have no guts to even call out. And then when we do call out these so-called rulers, leaders, we get canceled. We get thrown to the side. And then when they come, the pendulum shifts. like we were talking about earlier, like, you know, you have the left doing all this blah, 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 blah. And then now this whole Biden thing, now people from the right are like, point, see, it's like, but that doesn't work either.
Yeah.
If we could just say, you know what, man, hell yeah, you messed up. But I'm going to show you some grace because there's a bigger goal here. And the goal is this, peace.
And we're on the same
righteousness,
team.
Righteousness, stuff like that.
Yeah, I don't know. I think, you know, obviously where you are and where you are, you know, with Ephesians you just read right there. What is prayer? Think about what prayer is. Prayer is what? You don't pray and say, God, I would love it if you gave me a Lamborghini tomorrow, and I would love if we get a Ferrari. And if I get a $100,000 check, I will be more Christian next week. And if you give me that Ferragamo shoes with the nice Stefano Ricci suit, I'm going to go to church.
You're coming
times.
For Joel Osteen hard
so,
here.
Yeah, I'm going after Joel Osteen hard here. But you know what prayer is? Prayer forces you to think about other people. Mm. Prayer is, you know what? I'm praying for Gerard. You know, he's going through a certain phase right now. Probably Gerard told me something about his mom, his dad, his brother, sister. I'm going to pray for him, man. He looked like he was going through some time right now. Mm. I'm going to pray for Adam. You know, hey, you know, he's going through this. I'm going to pray for Tom. The part about prayer is makes you think about others. Meditation is more you most of the time. Mm. Prayer is out. You're praying for someone else. So what would happen if we're coming from that mindset? You're thinking about other people. Look, for me, all I know is you give me a great organization. You give me a great family that keeps winning. You're going to find strong values and principles there. And the moment values and principles goes away, havoc's about to take place. Mm-hmm. Okay, now the part about the faith that we didn't get into yesterday is how many people you know that use the Bible as a weapon? How many people do you know that use the scripture as a weapon?
I think history is chock full of them.
I don't disagree.
Yeah.
Yeah, Muslims may say a lot of people use the Quran as a weapon. 75% of them say this is a religion of what?
Peace.
Right? Hey, you know, there's extremists, but that's not us. Mm-hmm. You know, guns. Let's talk about guns. Is gun a good invention to the world?
I think it's one of the greatest inventions ever made.
Who did it help the most, men or women?
Women, by far.
What? Give me the split. 10 to 1, 20 to 1, 5 to 1? I mean,
we talked about this, you know, in podcasts past, but I mean, like, literally, this is the first time in the history of our species that not being big, strong, and violent is the marker of success. And that the gun has equaled the playing field for smaller people, more intelligent people even.
Yep.
If people are able to no longer just bully their way into success, you can't get in a ship with 16 other Norsemen and go, you know, across the English Channel and take over
just
an entire town.
Away.
Yeah. So, I mean, again, we talked about it with LeBron James, and I call him the repentant rich. I'm like, never in the history of man could somebody that was born in that status of life in Akron, Ohio, become a billionaire. He would have had to kill or been responsible for organizing an army that killed millions of people, hundreds of thousands of people, in order to go from poverty to a literal prince, a king like that. So, you know, the fact that he's a billionaire by playing ball and hole, and the fact that he can go and be on TV every day, where everybody knows where he is and they know that he has all this money and everything like that, and he doesn't have to worry about his family being at home or his stuff being at home. He doesn't go to sleep every night wondering if, oh my God, there's going to be marauders coming to take everything that I've earned in the middle of the night. He has indirectly guns to thank for that.
Yeah.
So
let me jump in for a sec. So there's two. We started this conversation with basically saying, look, we're a little off track here right now. You know, we kind of got to get our central nervous system of our consciousness together. But at the same time, like what you're saying, I think this is the best that humans have ever lived.
Ever.
Ever.
It's quantifiable.
So, exactly. Mm-hmm. So, you know, like Charles Dickens, it was the best of times, it's the worst of times. It's so easy to point out all the bad stuff. Oh, this guy on mushrooms, like it's crazy. ISIS, Al-Qaeda, whatever, whatever. How many people have been lifted out of poverty? How many people over the last 50 years? How many people have clean drinking water now? How many people, how many babies aren't dying because polio isn't killing them the second they're born? It's so easy to just jump on and pile on the bad, the negative, things are bad, which in some cases they are. But a lot of things are good, man.
Well,
a lot of things are good.
Things are good. I think the term is gratitude.
Mm-hmm.
And I think a lot of us have to live in that moment a little bit more, right? Like instead of just complaining and whining and bitching and moaning, we have to be in more gratitude. And like you said, I mean, we are living in some, very strange times, but at the same time, I mean, look, we're able to have this podcast, connect right. with people, you know, we'll be changing, you know, hopefully someone's perspective, life, whatever, in just us having this conversation,
yeah.
you know, but, you know, I feel very fortunate in a lot of things I get to do, and that's because of, you know, evolution.
So, Pat, let me ask you this. So, you brought up guns there. So, are you saying that religion to you is analogous to a gun?
Absolutely. A lot of people here are talking insane stuff. Like, let me read some, what a couple people said. Wars. Bible is Marco D. Pascal. Bible is mostly fake, and Paul Barraza is 100% right. You got another guy that's talking about most. Paul Barraza just gave $10, and he said most people in fairy tales, most believe in fairy tales, God, and religion. Sure, seek like it works. LOL. You know, people talking trash about God, right? And talking trash about Bible.
There's an interesting thing about the Bible, I will say. And I love this stuff, by the way. Like, I spend my weekends reading up about this stuff. I've told you about my affinity for the historical Jesus, whether I believe he's the Son of God or not. He's the greatest activist of all time. I am fascinated with the life of Yeshua. I'm fascinated by it. And really, the Bible, and this is going to piss some people off, but just try to have an open mind. The Bible really, all right, that we know today is a treaty between Judaism, monotheism, and the Roman Empire. Catholicism is a great, it's an understanding between the growing sects of Judaism. Jesus never wanted Christianity. He was a Jew, through and through, rabbi. And there was Roman Catholicism, right? Roman Catholicism was the, what's the word I'm looking for here? The compromise.
The okay.
It was the compromise between the dying old Roman ways and the new Roman as Rome became Eastern, not Western. So there's geopolitical, like, it's fascinating politics behind this stuff. If you can, and I'm not saying that Jesus isn't the Son of God. I'm not saying that it's not the Word of God. That's not what I'm saying. But if you believe that religion is of man, all right, and you know, if you can research the Council of Nicaea, understanding what this was from a political standpoint is the most fascinating times in human history. We're still talking about 2,000 years later. The Council of Nicaea shaped the world for the next, you know, 1,200, 1,300 years. It's a fascinating time, man. So anyway, I'm sorry. But
you asked a question, though. You asked a question saying the gun comparison to a Bible, right? Okay.
Yeah.
So here's how I see this. Anything can be used as a weapon. Anything can be used as a weapon, right? Mm-hmm. They say the moment you learn how to persuade, never go to the tipping point of manipulate just to avoid you being wrong at times. When you learn how to persuade, you're one move away from being a manipulator just because you don't want, because now you know how to win arguments, okay? So if the mission becomes about winning, you will tip into manipulating. Rather than persuading. I don't know if that makes sense.
Yeah,
or not.
Yeah, it's kind of like what lawyers are trained
yeah.
to do.
Yeah. Once you learn how to persuade, you're like, listen, this guy knows how to persuade. You know how to persuade. You know how to persuade. I know how to persuade. But there's like, you know what? In this argument, he's beating me. Screw it. I'm going to manipulate because I don't want to be. Yeah, and by the way, that's a problem. And that's a problem everybody with power that knows how to persuade has to deal with. Everybody. Happens in marriage, parenting,
right.
Everything. Okay, yeah. Let's set that part aside. Computer. That's a weapon. The Bible can be used as a weapon. This is a weapon. This right here is one of the most powerful weapons in the world today, right? Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So there's a couple arguments. Me, I went through the phase of trying to break everything down with the Bible to prove to everybody that the Bible is wrong. That was my outcome. You think the Bible is right? Yes. You mean to tell me that back in the days, a woman's going to have a baby without, and yeah, we have to believe it. You want me to believe it? This was the 23-year-old kid that would go to every pastor that he could find, and I would try to prove him wrong. That was this guy. We're 22, 23 years old. This is all I did for 2.5 years, right? Mm. You mean to tell me I have to believe that? Let me get this straight. What makes you think maybe she hooked up with a guy that nobody knew about, and then boom, next thing you know, she's got a baby. To save her, she has to say, well, this is a God, all this stuff, right? Okay. Then people say, well, let's just say she made that up. Okay? Let's just say she made that up. What are the freaking chances that she makes up the story and the kid ends up becoming the biggest influencer in the world? Right. Let's say, so for me, the skeptic is like,
well,
well, there's chances. What are the chances? 1 in 113 freaking billion? Okay, math genius, break that down for me. Then I back up. I'm like, fuck, that was a... Let me take a different angle. Right. Well, back in the days, people were so naive. And a person could come up with a great communicator. They can manipulate everybody. So you can use that as a weapon to manipulate others. Okay, great. It's still happening today. But fine, let's just say the naivety level is lower today. Right. Mm-hmm. People were more naive back in the days because they wanted to be controlled. Every time I went to it, finally it got to the following point. Here's what the point is. Are there some things you will never know about your dad and your mom that they will never tell you? Okay. Are there stuff you're never going to know about your parents? Like, you know, a couple of the arguments or that part or this part. Are there things that you will never find out? Yes or no?
100%.
Yeah. If you spend the rest of your life trying to figure out 100% accuracy of who's right, mom or dad, are you ever going to find that out? Yes or no? You're never going to find it out, right? No. Okay. You can spend the rest of your life trying to find out every single thing about Christianity, Jesus, God, everything. Are you going to find that 100% truth of all of it? 100% truth. Not 99%. Not 98%, 100% truth. So then that leaves us with what? Okay, so you got emotional, you got logical. Let's look at both sides. Okay, for me, on the logical side, do I want my kids to learn certain values and principles to follow? Do I feel more comfortable a country is being built on certain set of values and principles? Yes. Would I rather have my kids go to church and not go to church? Yes. Would I rather have my kids pray than not to pray? Yes. Would I rather have my kids go to an atheist school or a Jewish school, and I'm a Christian myself? I would much rather have. Would I rather have my kids be held accountable to a certain level? So this whole thing about you're right, you're delusional, you're this, you're that. Look, you're talking to a guy that spent the entire time trying to mathematically prove everybody wrong in the concept of Bible. And, oh, Noah, you mean to tell me this guy built a ship and two animals on each side and came in all? You mean, come on, bro, that's a freaking fictional story. You believe that? I don't know. You mean to tell me that such and such? I don't know. What I'm trying to tell you is I don't know. What I am telling you is if a person reads Proverbs, they become a better human being. Mm-hmm. I don't know why. Mm-hmm. Go read Proverbs and see what happens to you. I don't know why. I don't care what you are. Just go start with Proverbs. Read and see what happens to you afterwards. I think we need a little bit. This is coming from a guy that's a sinner. This is coming from a guy that's flawed. This is coming from a guy that's done a lot of stupid shit in his life. But if I ever go more that side, I make better decisions. I think today, if there's ever been a time, the country that was founded on the right belief system, who ends up beating everyone in only 200 years against empires that have been around for a few thousand years, maybe this country has been blessed. And yeah, maybe we need to kind of go back a little bit and say, what was the reasoning? Was it us? Or was there something else that was on our side? I don't know.
I would say this, and this is where I would agree with the kind of Judeo-Christian framework that you guys talked about before, right? I don't think that the quote-unquote atheist today doesn't believe in a higher power. I think government is their higher power. I think that they believe in this system, the socialist system, as their Judeo-Christian framework. I believe that this, especially this nouveau democratic socialist, this isn't politics to them. This is religion to them. And I think part of the argument that we've had over the course of the last 10 years is you just talked about intellectual versus emotional. Politics is an intellectual conversation. There's ebb and there's flow. There's times where you need liberalism and there's times where you need conservatism.
No question.
There's, you know, I always try to think in a binary system. You know, you like to say two wings of the same bird. I think of the Democrats as the gas pedal and the Republicans as the brake. You need gas to move forward. You need a brake or you're going to fall off the cliff, right? So I think we've gone awry in our country in the last 10 years, and I think it's coming from the outside world specifically hammering us, is this kind of global communism, this democratic socialism. This is religion to people. For all the same ways, I even said this to you guys last night, where you guys are saying, all right, well, you got to think of your neighbor. You need to think of someone bigger than yourself. You have to provide. I'm like, this is what I hear from socialists all the time. This is social justice rhetoric. You know, this is the stuff that they are all the time saying. The people at the top have too much. The people at the bottom need to be taken care of. You got to think of somebody other than yourself. I'm like, this is socialist rhetoric. And then you made a great point. What is the difference? There is one key difference, yep. And there's one difference that separates everything, and that is?
Force.
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 Yeah. I have the choice. You know, you don't have to pray. I'm cool with that.
Right.
You don't have to give money. I'm cool with that. It's a choice. How many times have I gone to church and not given anything? Hundreds of times. Not one. Oh my gosh, what a sinner. I'm telling you the truth. What am I going to tell you? I didn't give anything that day I went to church. I've gone to church so many times.
There's a great Irish joke about that. You ever hear the Irish Catholic joke about that?
But the point is, I still walked out. It was a choice.
Yeah. Did you ever hear the Irish Catholic? So the old Paddy McDowell. Old Paddy McDowell goes in and he says, "Forgive me, Father. I have sinned. It's been 7 days since my last confession." "Well, what'd you do, Paddy?" "Well, you know, I lusted over me neighbor's wife." I said, "Well, did you do anything?" "No, but I thought about it. I thought about it a lot, and I thought about it constantly." "Well, you know, thinking about it is just as bad as doing it, my son. So I'm going to need you to repent. I repent. And we're going to need penance. What do I need to do, Father?" "7 Hail Marys and put 10 quid in the box on your way out to show God you mean it." So he says his Hail Marys, and then he goes to the donation box, takes the quid out, and he holds it over the top and then puts it back in his pocket and walks. And the pastor goes out. He goes, whoa, Paddy, what happened? I thought you were repenting." He goes, "Well, Father, I listened to your words, and I thought about it, and that's just as bad as doing it. So I figured God's okay."
Anyways, by the way, you know, it's crazy. The for me, for years, we followed the rhetoric, which is what? Which is never talk politics, never talk religion, never talk this kind of stuff, and this is what we're talking about all today. If you don't like it, this ain't a podcast for you, I guarantee you. But if you like it, smash that subscribe button, put a thumbs up to help us out with the algorithms, because we got a few more topics to go in the next 39 minutes.
Let me give you one more thing.
Here we go, folks. Everybody, pay attention. Turn off the computer. Tell your kids to be quiet. Yes. Adam's got some thoughts for us.
I'd be remiss if I didn't just bring up
I'm thinking you're going to pray for all of us.
Well, it does involve prayer.
Let's hear it.
I think, you know, prayer or affirmation or meditation or thinking of others is important. Okay, no doubt. And I think, you know, whether they say, "Hey, take a second, moment of silence," that's great. But the whole blanket, "We had an issue, thoughts and prayers. Hey, can you get your thoughts and prayers out there today?"
Yep.
"Hey, I you know, my dad's sick, really could use your thoughts and prayers."
Yeah.
"Hey, we just had another gun tragedy, thoughts and prayers." At the end of the day, thoughts and prayers don't do shit.
Yes.
They don't solve problems.
If they don't mean anything.
Oh, that's what I'm saying. Like, yeah, the old actions. Thoughts and prayers thing. I'm just so sick of the thoughts and prayers thing.
Are you sick of virtue signaling, or are you sick of praying?
The virtue signaling. Yeah. But it's not me getting political. It's just the, "Hey, thoughts and prayers."
Mm-hmm.
We just had another 50 people guy from a gun violence. We really could use some.
That's just like when I have friends from the UK, right? So, like, I you know, travel and... You know, I have a couple buddies out in Birmingham, England, right? So they'll say, "Why is it that you guys always say, 'Have a nice day'?"
Mm-hmm.
He's like, "You guys don't mean that shit one bit."
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. "Have a nice day. Have a nice day." It's just a saying. So I totally agree with what you're saying. I mean, at the end of the day, we got to say what we mean.
I know you want to move on, Pat, but one thing that I did want to ask you about this, man, is, I mean, you've talked about this a lot. I mean, it's interesting that you want increased religion, increased accountability. But you grew up in an environment where, you know, religion gone awry completely turned your world upside down.
Yeah, but it was force. Again, it goes back to force.
Mm-hmm.
My kids, everything is a choice. "Hey, you don't have to read today. It's the currency of the house. But I don't have to let you watch TV today. But you don't have to ever read in my house. But I don't have to ever let you watch TV in our house. It's a choice." Mm-hmm. "Hey, you don't have to clean your bed. Believe me, buddy, like I tell my son, you don't need to." Who said you need to clean your bed? "Nobody said you need to clean your bed. But I don't need to let you play iPad this weekend. It's a choice." There's always a choice, right? "I'm still going to love you. You're still going to be my son. I'm still going to take care of you. But I'm sorry, video games don't come if you don't do your part. I got to do my part. Life is tough. I got to do." So the force part is the problem in countries like Iran, because you don't have the choice. "Hey, you want to cover your hair? No problem. Do it. You don't? No problem. Do it." That was the Shah's way. "You want to cover yourself? Go for it."
Mm-hmm.
Some people want to wear, like, you know, show everything, cleavage. And they want to have the shirt high and show their belly buttons because it's pierced, and wear skimpy, what do you call it, skirts. Guess what? I'm sure you support that. You know, I'm sure you're...
Vehemently.
Now, somebody who's extremely attractive doesn't want to show any of it. She only wants to show it to her man. So every time you see her, you're like, "She's dropped it gorgeous, but I have no clue because she's always covered up." That's her choice. Great. Mm-hmm. She wants to. Somebody goes to the beach, they wear a two-piece, and they got a thong on. Okay. Now, that's kind of weird, but I like it. Let's just say you like it. Some people go there. They don't want to wear that. It's a choice. The force is the problem, is when the problem becomes a little bit problematic for me. So, but to go back to what you just said, And I've heard that a million times. Hey, David, can you grab somebody to grab a charger for my iPad, please? My iPad just died. If you guys got it, I wouldn't mind it. Here's what I will say about what you just said, okay? I partially agree and I partially disagree. Let me explain. Who have I known longer, you or Tom?
Tom.
Okay. Who gave $10,000 to Obama and Trump and said, committed to, I'm going to give $10,000 for this to happen?
Your boy Sauce.
Who else here gave that?
I don't know.
But who here supports for that to become a reality?
Everyone.
Did Mario give anything?
Not that Mario Aguilar. No, not him.
Mario didn't give anything.
Yeah.
But does Mario want to support me doing the interview to see Bush and Obama and Trump in the same room?
Of course.
I think that there's levels to support. Mm-hmm. Some go above and beyond. Some people, all they can do is say, dude, I'm just going to pray for you. I got nothing else to give you. What do you want me to do? My thoughts and prayers go for you, right? Some say, hey, I'm not only going to pray for you, I'm going to make a phone call to see if I can get a guy to support you. Hey, not only am I going to pray for you, I'm going to make a phone call, but I'm also going to come out to your place to help you out. Whatever you need, I got you.
Okay.
Some say thoughts and prayers. Some say call a friend. Some come, and some go and give $50,000 or $10,000. So there's levels. I don't mind it. As long as the effort is to give something. If you want to give time to pray for me, that's a starter. There's levels in life. You know, hey, if somebody works at a company, not everybody's going to be a C-suite executive. Somebody may come here and make sure the place is clean. You're contributing to society. Somebody wants to come in here and edit. Fantastic. Somebody wants in here to cut. Great. Somebody wants to grab. I don't, as long as we're contributing. The part about prayer is the barrier to enter is just to pray. Go for it. There's no expectation. That's much better than a guy says, screw you. I don't care what happens to this guy. Mm. So it's a way to at least get people started.
I hear you on that. There's levels to this. So but imagine you're raising, you're trying to, you pledged $5 million, right?
Yep.
And Aaron Singerman called in. He gave half a million. I gave 10,000.
Yep.
This person. That's great. Imagine if you were trying to raise $100 million. Yep. Okay. Hypothetically. And all you got was a million people giving you their thoughts and prayers. And my point is this, it's just empty. It's just thoughts and prayers.
I think
how many people give you a thoughts and prayers and literally don't think or pray? They just write that down and move on with their life.
But guess who's responsible for that?
That's on everybody.
That's their character. That's their character. They're held responsible. It only hurts one person. It's themselves. You know,
my problem is if there's actually something that needs to get done, whether pick healthcare, pick gun violence, pick the Green New Deal, whatever it is, and then just thoughts and prayers. It doesn't get things done.
It's
is
a choice,
my point.
Though. I like choices. If you don't want to do it, and I leave it on you.
That's fine. Yeah. I'm just saying that I need something more. If you're looking to raise
you're
money, I'm just saying if I'm looking to raise money for a cause.
Yeah.
And all you're hitting me with is a million people give me thoughts and prayers, buddy. I need actual money. I need actual help. Yeah. I need you to volunteer.
I know what you're saying.
Whatever.
I think what you're
thoughts
saying
and prayers is just an easy way out.
Is
it's
the
a cop
fake
out.
Side of it. The
it's fake.
Yeah, there are people. There are some that will do it through fake. Look,
just for social equity.
Yeah, I fully get that.
So if you enjoyed this little short segment from the podcast that we did, here's another short segment to watch. Or if you want to see the entire podcast, click over here. Take care, everybody. Bye-bye.